mean, change only comes from heretics and people who disagree with what's going on. But for everybody that wants to say something or does something, and you're a catalyst for making things change, you have a responsibility to act correct when you go. And the police are not in opposition to that. Most of them are with you. And that's the main thing to focus on, is that they're not the enemy. And if they choose to be the enemy, then them acting incorrect makes your message look that much better. If you can act correct while they're acting incorrect, then they lose. And the ones that support them and put them into that position of acting incorrect lose. You win the moral battle. And we're here for about justice. We're here because people are actually breaking laws, and it's offensive. It isn't that it's just somebody has privilege. They're breaking laws. You know, it's our government, it's our system, it's nobody else's. And we're there to say, this is the way it is. In an uprising where you bring everybody in and you win, enough people say, this is ours and we've had enough. If we're the, you know, I'm the 100%, I'm here for everybody. And those people who don't want to make it work, they need healing. And we're here to heal them. But you have to have a movement that is successful. No, they're not getting out because they're going to do their action. I mean, the purpose of what police infiltrators do is they try to find who's the most radical person, and they want to set them up and they want to get them into trouble. They're going to use the situation of pulling off to get people into trouble and to lead them astray. And, you know, it happened with right. Are you work on healing them? There's techniques that we do in having rallies, and it's you have your peacekeepers. For every 10 people, you have one trained peacekeeper. And when a situation erupts and you do have a provocateur, you can engage them in conversations and pull them away from the situation. And you can create your own confrontation with your peacekeepers and a provocateur to where you can spin them out. It's like if you ever have a fly circling around you, and you stand next to somebody else, and then the fly circles around them, and then that fly is circling that person. You can use, I call it the circling fly technique, and you can take a provocateur and take them out to the edge of the situation, and you can keep them spinning around people and keep them spinning around to where they've left the situation. There's ways and techniques of working with people to where you can control your message, but you have to have people who are dedicated and willing to let go of their ego to serve the message. And it's a powerful message that we're trying to promote. You know, you're there strictly to heal and to make things change happen, but you're there to be successful so other people want to join you. I mean, Occupy Dallas said, last time I checked on the Facebook when it first started, had 18,000 likes on it. There's potentially 18,000 people that were willing to come out and do something, and out of that 18,000, you could have had 180,000 people participating. But when you get a small group of people and their egos acting out, thinking that they're doing it, you have to surrender yourself. You have to have a bigger message that's inclusive. And when the energy's there to make the change, you can take it and you can accelerate it to incredible levels. Occupy brought out all kinds of feelings and thoughts that crossed all boundaries. You know, most people don't believe you can steal, lie, or murder. And these are basic core values that we all have no matter what political direction you come from. And what Occupy did was they awakened those core values to saying, hey, we're all getting screwed. And this is enough. And everybody can agree that we're all getting screwed and this is enough. And we're there to promote something. When I was in Crawford, Texas, over half of the McClendon Sheriff's Department was on our side. You know, half of the police department was there. The majority of them were on our side. So the police, these, you know, 200 squad cars that were surrounding us, 100 of them were with us, you know? And it's like, the police are there to do, they have a job. They're getting paid to do something. But if their hearts are there and you're correct and they can identify with you, then you win. You help it to where they can identify you, but don't get distracted by their niceness either. Mm-hmm. You know, because when there's an agenda that's handed down from their city council or even from Obama, if Obama said enough of this Occupy, it's gone down, and all the Occupies are shut down at the same time from teleconferencing, mm-hmm. then there's a huge agenda, and the energy's just is moved. And we lost our momentum because there was an underground attack against the whole movement existing. But the solidarity of people together could overridden that as a technique. You know, there's ways to solve it if you empty yourself and you're there to serve. The answers are available. Private property could have been made available, but because the situation had become drug-ridden and full of homeless people, which homeless people deserve to have the rights, and it's a great source of bodies that want to make changes, but there was a lot of things that were underlying things that were messed up with the Occupy movement because so many people didn't have the experience and the training to deal with it as an army of folks that want to make change. You know, you can take an incredible people who've never even considered being peaceful. The world's largest nonviolent army was from the Pashtuns in Afghanistan and Pakistan. The Khoda Khidgamar, led by Abdul Ghaffar Khan, is the world's largest nonviolent army, and they're the ones that actually neutered the British Empire with Gandhi. They took the brunt of the force of the British Army, and they were the most brutal to them, but this 100,000 member nonviolent army are the ones that really took down the British Empire with Gandhi. You know, it's possible. These were Pashtuns. These are the same people that the U.S. is at war with in Afghanistan. The world's largest nonviolent army is where we're at war right now. And the truces that are breaking out and the people that are trying to change are the ones that still have that basic background. So, I mean, you can take the roughest people in the world, rough tribalmen in Afghanistan, and train them into a nonviolent army. That is just, you know, this is where Gandhi used to go take vacations with these guys. You know, it's an amazing thing that if people are moved to act and they see correctness, people are willing to join. Occupy, I was at Occupy 1 year anniversary in New York, and the police shut down Wall Street. Occupy didn't shut down Wall Street, the police did it. You know, what a great gift from the police department for a one-year anniversary to shut down Wall Street. Yeah. Six people walking across the street and stopping and doing a mic check was called for 100 police officers to show up with a paddy wagon. And then they would just walk off the street and keep going on the crosswalk, walking real slow. They did that circling Wall Street, just groups of people, six people, doing mic check while slowly walking across the street. The police went ballistic. And that's what shut down Wall Street. You know, it was a great gift. I mean, the police shut down Wall Street as a gift to Wall Street for its one-year anniversary. I mean, what a great thing. You know, who's to say that they weren't on your side? I mean, it became more about protecting the Wall Street bull and people having their picture taken next to his balls. You know, it was like... That was like they were defending the bull's balls from pictures. You know, that was like the main thing that the police were doing that day. And they were harassing anybody that went inside trying to get their ID. And, you know, they just made life hell on Wall Street. And it was the police shut down Wall Street that day. It was an amazing gift. So, I mean, don't discount the police and how they can work for you. You know, it's possible, but you have to have tactics and selflessness and a message that people can join you. You know, my main thing is to say don't be afraid to win and have a vision of what it looks like to win and to be successful. And in that, let the police join you. I'm sorry, was somebody asking a question? Go ahead. Sure.
your blog ignored?
Okay, you want to do an action at a rest at a, on a public highway, on a highway? Okay. Okay. Okay.
So, you can play with these buttons, right? Yes. See?
Right.
Let me go back to it.
You saw
it. Right?
No, no. My phone, you just have to push which one of these buttons.
It's, I love it.
Repeat the question.
Okay. I do.
Sure. Department and,
sure.
And they just thought I was totally off my rocker when I told them we wanted to have a band and, you know, I mean, not big, huge band, but, you know,
no, I got it.
Play
I got
the guitar, some, you know, a drum circle maybe, just, you know, something.
So what your concern is that
inevitably, these are going to come.
Right.
And we're looking at around Waxahachie area.
Sure.
Sure.
Okay, your question, I believe, is what would a confrontation or how would you deal with police in a truck stop having an event? Now, what comes to mind a parallel is the Rainbow Family. That if they meet at a national park, and there's like anywhere from 15,000 to 40,000 people meet in a national park, and if you have like over 40 people, you're supposed to have a permit. Now, what's unusual about the Rainbow Family is that they don't have leaders, and every individual is, or they don't have followers. Every individual is a leader, and they just happen to show up at the same time at the same place. So if you have people showing up at the same time if everybody shows up as an individual in a car, and wants to be at a stop, and nobody's a leader, then there's nobody to have a confrontation with. There you just have individuals that are everywhere. One of the parallels that I can also relate to is one time we had an anti-sanctions against Iraq rally at the Kennedy Memorial, and I had a banner that says "Sanctions Kill," and we were holding up against the Kennedy Memorial, and the police officer came up to me and said, we'd like to speak to the person, we'd like to speak to someone in charge. And I said, God's in charge. And he said, I need somebody I can talk to. And I said, I'm really sorry for you. And so they called up the next officer, and they got the staff sergeant. I think they went through like 4 or 5 different police officers that were coming up and telling us that, you know, we couldn't have a banner there. We didn't have a permit. And they, you know, each one would show up and they'd say, who's in charge? And they'd say, don't ask him that, don't ask him that. And I'd say, God's in charge. And then finally some lady showed up that was like the top person in the department in that area. And she walks in and she goes, who's in charge? And all the police turned around at her and said, don't ask him. And I said, God's in charge. And I said, they said, well, you can't be here holding up a banner. And I said, why? You know, where's your permit? And I said, it was printed 200 years ago. Over 200 years ago.
Oh.
And another thing we used to do in Crawford. Okay. There's a quick summary is that you asked about having an event at a rest stop, and my thought was a parallel is the Rainbow Family, where they have 40,000 people come camp in a national forest, and they're all individuals that show up, and there's no followers. Everybody's a leader. So when they ask who's in charge, there's everybody's in charge or nobody's in charge. It's an event that a bunch of individuals decide to come together, so there's no one to blame and there's no one to arrest for being a leader. And if somebody wants to get out some music, then it's whether you can play a guitar at a rest stop, you know. The whole thing is, is how do you, you know, how do you diffuse the situation? Like, I had, one time I had a house that we built, and we were on the side of the road, and it had, it was about public housing and military spending. It was outside the Dallas post office, and the highway department told us we couldn't build a structure on city, on the highway property. And so we held it up in the air, and I said, it's a sign. But we had this house that was 10 foot square and 8 feet tall, with maybe 10 feet tall with a peaked roof on it. And so they gotten called in against us, and we held up, we said it was a sign, and it was our First Amendment rights, and they left us alone, because as long as we were holding it, but when it touched the ground, it became a structure. So there's all kinds of ways to, there's ways to deal with stuff by being specific, but don't feed them the information. If you're calling a lawyer, if you're asking the highway department if you're illegal, then you have a beforehand knowledge of the situation. It's best when they show up to tell them you don't understand what law you're breaking. If you tell them you don't understand, then they it's their responsibility. If you take responsibility for it, then you're clearly stating that you understand and you're a person who could be arrested as somebody who's organizing something that's... You just, before you can be arrested, you have to understand the charges against you. And if you don't understand, they can't arrest you. And they're going to try everything they can. Listen to their voice. Everything they're going to try to say to you is, do you understand? And if you keep on saying no, the conversation doesn't get go forward. If you're in the court, the judge will they'll read you the charges against you, and they'll ask you if you understand. If you say, I don't understand, the court case can't proceed. They might lock you up, but they're not going to. You can't proceed the case without understanding the charges against you. And if the charges violate the Constitution of the United States, how can you possibly understand? You know, what are the rules? There's rules against having an organized party at a truck at a rest stop, but I don't think there's rules against having fun at a rest stop.
Yes.
You know, and if you have a bus full of people that are having a picnic, and somebody wants to get out of the car, guitar and sing at the picnic, it's okay. You know, what you in a situation like that, you don't want to set up the case against you beforehand. I think being spontaneous and then have your peacekeepers and have a group of people who are trained to deal with the police, spin them around in circles until your event's done. I mean, there's ways that... I've had rallies where Confederate skinheads came up to tear down our banners and beat up our speakers. And we had enough peacekeepers to take 14 of them and spin them off to the sides, and we were striking the stage before they knew that the thing had, that what had even happened. I mean, it's possible to make a successful event without having enemies.
Somebody tell Jack about I Don't Know More Light Brigade.